Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. I haven't realized Grenoble is such a beautiful place surrounded by mountains. So the topic of my course would be Diophantine approximation and the flows on homogeneous spaces. So Diophantine approximation and flows on homogeneous spaces. So maybe first I should say what do I mean by Diophantine approximation. So the basic question that we would be interested in throughout this lecture is of the following flavor. So say we are given a vector x in RD, and we would like to find a reasonably efficient approximation of this vector x by rational vectors. And of course, it's a very classical topic in number theory, but in recent years, it turns out, and of course, there are many different approaches to this problem. At least in dimension one, there is a continued fraction approach, and some of the theory of continued fractions can be generalized to higher dimensions, but sometimes multidimensional fractions don't work as well as one-dimensional ones. But it turns out that there is also a dynamical approach to these problems, and so I would like to explain some of the ideas lying behind this approach. And in this short lecture series, it would be not so easy to explain all the technology that comes into this topic. So I guess the philosophy of my lectures would be to explain how some of the technology in dynamical systems can be applied to Diophantine approximation. And sometimes I wouldn't be able to actually give you a full introduction to the technology itself, but at least you later on you would know that if you see similar problems, you might know that this technology is useful, and you would be interested in learning more about it. So what can we say about Diophantine approximation? So the starting point, which I should definitely mention, is the classical theorem by Dirichlet. Which says that for every vector x for every parameter r, say bigger than one, if we look on the system of inequalities, so distance from x to a rational number p over q less than r to the power 1 minus 1 over d divided by q, and q less than r. So the system of inequalities has solutions PQ in ZD times N. So in particular, if you take R sufficiently large, you can get a very good rational approximation, and you can control the size of R. So in some sense, this result is best possible because maybe as you have seen last week, so there are numbers which are badly approximable, which are somehow the worst situation happens where, when the number is quadratic irrational. And so for quadratic irrationals, it's really, well, if you here you put an arbitrary small constant, then the analog of Dirichlet's theorem would already fail. So one can see it using, well, you can think about it from the point of view of continued fractions, or you can actually do an elementary argument for quadratic irrationals. But still, so let me ask the question whether this can be improved. So can this be improved, at least for some families of X's? So, so we can set up the question as follows. So we fix, say, a continuous non-increasing function psi from positive reals to 0, 1. And then we say, so a vector x is psi approximable if so I look on the similar system of inequalities. So if I look on the inequalities distance from x minus p over q less than psi of r divided by q and q less than r. So if the system of inequalities has solutions for for a sequence of Rn's going to infinity. So in particular, if my function psi is x to the power minus 1 over d, then from Dirichlet's theorem, we know that every number is, every vector is psi approximable. But we can still wonder what happens if we if we put a function which decays faster than this function. So and let me also denote by W d psi. This would be the set of all psi approximable vectors. And so what can we say about the set of psi approximable vectors? So the answer is provided by the classical theorem of Hinchin. So there are two parts. So the first part says that if the sum of psi of q to the power d, so if the sum converges, then the set of psi approximable numbers has measure zero. So as a subset of Rd. So in this situation, psi decays too fast to find many psi approximable numbers. On the other hand, if the same sum is infinite, then the set of psi approximable numbers has a full measure. So So typical, I should say vectors, not numbers. So typical vectors in RD would be psi approximable. So for example, we can see from the theorem immediately that for almost every x, if we look on the system of inequalities. Say r minus 1 over d log r minus 1 over d divided by q and q less than r. So here we are adding extra power of log, and it turns out that for almost all x, this system of inequalities again has solutions. So in that sense, Dirichlet's theorem indeed can be improved for generic vectors. So so how would we think about this problem? So maybe a first basic remark is that the set of psi approximable numbers is a Lim-Sup set. So so first we remark that W d psi is a Lim-Sup of the ball centered at rational points and a radius so let's see what is the best way to. Yeah, so you know what is Lim-Sup set. So if you have a family of sets, then the set is a Lim-Sup set. So this is set of points which belong to infinitely many sets from this collection. So and so in particular, we can analyze the size of the set using the usual Borel-Cantelli type arguments. So maybe I should recall the classical Borel-Cantelli lemma. So here we consider very generally a collection of measurable sets in some measure space, say X mu. And then Borel-Cantelli lemma says that if the size of those sets is so the sum of the measures of those sets is finite, then Lim-Sup would be small. So the set Lim-Sup An would have a measure zero. So I think most of you have seen this Borel-Cantelli lemma in a measure theory course, but if you haven't, it's actually a very nice exercise to prove. And so what we observe right away is that the first part of Hinchin theorem is actually easy part. So So Borel-Cantelli lemma implies the first part of the Hinchin theorem. So what do you have to do? So simply you would look on a collection of those balls, say contained which are in the unit box in RD, and then you have to estimate what is the measure of those balls. So that's really an easy computation, and then you see that the condition that the sum is finite would correspond exactly to this condition in the Borel-Cantelli lemma. So that's really quite elementary, but the second part is really very interesting property. So to prove the second part, we would need the converse of Borel-Cantelli lemma. There is no literal converse of the lemma, so it could be that the sum of the measures is infinite, but lim sub set is still quite large. So you can think, well, maybe I leave it to you as an exercise. So you can maybe take a sequence of shrinking intervals with the same center. So one can cook up, maybe shrinking to the boundary of the interval. So one can cook up an example where literal converse is not true. So one needs additional condition. And so here is one version of the converse. So again, we have a collection of measurable sets in some measure space. And then we assume that, first of all, that sum of the measures is infinite. But we also assume that the sets AN are independent in some weak sense. So what we assume that if we take the sum, say, over N and M from 1 to big N, mu of AN intersection mu of AM. So what we want to say is that these sets are approximately independent. So in the sense of probability theory, right? So if the sets were independent, then the sum would be equal to this measure would be equal to product of the measures, and then the sum would be equal to I guess I can write it like this. Yes, AN. So this would be independence in the sense of probability theory, but this would be too strong for many applications, in particular for most number theoretic applications. So one needs a weaker condition. So what we assume is that the sum is bounded by this term plus some fixed constant sum n from 1 to n mu of a n. So by the way, so this expression we can write more simply as so if we assume these two conditions, so that the sum of the measures is infinite plus this weak notion of independence, it turns out that the lim sup of the sets AN has a full measure. Okay, so so let's maybe let me give a sketch of the proof why this converse is true. So so let me denote by Sn Sn of x. This would be sum n from 1 to n characteristic function of a n of x, and also let's denote by e n. Well, basically the integral of this expression. So, so it would be a sum n from 1 to n mu of a n. And so, so what we notice right away is that x would belong to lim sup of the sets a n if and only if s n of x goes to infinity as n goes to infinity. So why is this? So for example, if x belongs to lim sup, it means that there are infinitely many a n's which contain x. So then, of course, if you take the sum from 1 to infinity, there would be infinitely many ones in the sum, and so you get infinity, right? And conversely, so what we actually have to show is that for almost all x, this sum Sn of x goes to infinity. And so in order to prove this, first let's try to to do an estimate and compare L2 norm. How close Sn to its integral. So let's try to compute this expression. So so we can write L2 norm as follows. So it's And then we simply multiply things out, right? So, maybe first let's say we can factor out the sums. So then I get sum n m from 1 to big n L2 scalar product a n minus mu of a n. And characteristic function of AM minus mu of AM. So so now we can compute what the scalar product is. So we just multiply out, and what do we get? So so if we take product of two characteristic functions, so then remember L2 norm is given as an integral, so you would have to integrate of characteristic function of AN times characteristic function of AM, but this is the same as characteristic function of the intersection. So what you get mu of AN intersection AM. Well, there would be term which comes from product of this constant times this constant. So let's see. And well, so basically, it's just multiplying out. So maybe I shouldn't spend much time on it. So and now you see that we can apply a condition. So this quasi-independence condition that we assumed, and so so we see that. So what I'm getting this expression minus that expression. So, so this can be estimated by constant times En. And so, so what I can conclude from this computation is that if I divide everything by e to the n squared, then Sn divided by En minus 1 L2 norm is bounded by constant divided by En, and so it converges to zero. So we see that so we see that this ratio would converge to one in L2 norm. So, so we proved something about L2 norm, but what we really want, we want an almost everywhere convergence. But so it's not always true that L2 convergence implies almost everywhere convergence. But what is true? So if you know that the sequence of functions converges in L2, what can we say about almost everywhere convergence? Yes, exactly. Subsequence. Thank you. Subsequence. So then we know that there is a subsequence of n's such that S n I divided by E n I converges almost everywhere to one. And now we use the first condition, right? So by the first condition, we know that En goes to infinity. So denominator goes to infinity. This means that numerator has to go to infinity. So hence, SNI x almost everywhere converges to infinity. Well, but in our case, we are summing characteristic functions. So, so the sequence Sn that we get is actually monotone in n. So, so since Sn of x is a monotone in n, this actually implies that so we have convergence just as n goes to infinity. And this is exactly exactly what we wanted to show. So so now we see that for almost all x, the sum is the sum goes to infinity, and so for almost all x, lim sup. So for almost all x, x belongs to the lim sup of An. So so that's a really nice lemma in measure theory. But what we see now is that. Is that the essence of the proof of second part of Hinchin theorem would be to show that this balls, so the balls centered at rational points, have some kind of quasi-independence property. So all the proofs of Hinchin theorem go through showing some kind of version of quasi-independence property. And of course, there are different ways to show quasi-independence. And so what I'll try to explain in this lecture that one can do it using technology from homogeneous dynamics, from flows on homogeneous spaces. And so so now let me introduce some notation. So that's where dynamics comes in. So I have to talk a little bit about yeah, okay, but this one doesn't go up. So yeah, but okay, so I have to be careful because some of the notations I would need later on. So space of so space of lattices. So let me denote by y. So this is going to be the space of lattices. Lattices in RD of covolume one. So so every element in Y would be of the form say Z V1. Well, maybe just so everything fits together, let me put D plus one. So the space of lattices in RD plus one of covolume one. So every element in Y would be of the form Z V1 plus dot 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 Z Vd plus one, where Vi is a basis of RD plus one. So you can imagine you maybe fix a basis V1 and V2, and then you consider all integral linear combinations of these vectors. So you are going to get a grid like this. So each element of the space is a lattice, right? Of this type, and so so we also have a natural group action. So we observe that the group SL D plus one R naturally acts on the space. So if you have a lattice, you can multiply it by a matrix, and because determinant is one, so you still get a lattice with covolume one. And so, and then moreover, if you have two bases with covolume one, you can move one of the bases to the other using such linear transformation. So in fact, this group would act transitively on the space of lattices. And because of this, we can also think about the space as a homogeneous space of SLDR. So SLD plus one R, right? So SLD plus one R acts transitively, and then we can pick the lattice ZD plus one. So if you look on the stabilizer of the standard lattice ZD plus one, then in order to stabilize it, the matrix should have integral entries. So the stabilizer would be exactly SL D plus one Z. So what we see is that this space is naturally can be written as a factor space, SL D plus one Z, SL D plus one R factor SL D plus one Z. So there is actually very interesting dynamics which happens on this space. So in particular, well, maybe I just use. Yeah, is it okay if I move the board down? Have you finished taking notes? Okay, so maybe let me just start with continue with the top board. So, yeah, so now we actually have to introduce some notations and some more notations. So So it turns out that there is a very close dictionary between which connects dynamics on the space of lattices and the problems of Diophantine approximation. So I have to set up important notations. So say if I have a vector x in Rd, then for every such vector I can associate a lattice lambda sub x in the space Y. So this lattice would be defined as the standard lattice Zd plus 1 times the following matrix. Or if you like more explicitly, so this lattice can be written as say P plus X plus Q times X, Q, P Q belongs to Z D plus 1. So given a vector x, we construct this lattice. Another useful notation is we consider a one-parameter subgroup. A sub t. Which is defined as e to the t identity e to the minus dt 0, 0. So this is a one-parameter diagonal subgroup in SLD plus 1 R. It turns out that somehow there is a very close connection between dynamics of this one-parameter subgroup and the properties of Diophantine approximation. So that was it actually goes back even before that, but somehow. In the modern time, this was observed by Dani. So I'm going to call it Dani correspondence. So on one side, we are interested in Diophantine. Properties of a vector x in Rd. So finding a good Diophantine approximation for this vector. And on the other hand, we have this one-parameter flow. So then we can look on the corresponding orbit in the space of lattices. So So we can ask the orbit lambda sub x at is distributed in the space of lattices. And so this would become clear in the proof, but somehow the, so it's really so it turns out that there is a very powerful connection between these two objects, which at first seem to be quite different. So maybe I should make this connection precise. Let me introduce another piece of notation. So I'm going to denote by k of epsilon. So this is going to be a set of lattices in our space Y with the property. So those would be kind of degenerate lattices, the lattices which contain very short vectors. So such that lattices such that minimum over V in lambda minus zero norm of V is less than epsilon. So imagine if you have somehow most of the lattices would look maybe like this, right? There would be vector v1 and v2, and then there would be a neighborhood of zero, which doesn't contain any non-trivial vector in the lattice. But of course, there are also lattices which are very degenerate. So it could be a lattice which maybe looks like this. So there could be because it has to be covolume one, but I could have one very short vector and one very long vector. And so I could have maybe lattices like this. So those lattices are in some sense degenerate lattices. And so if we draw symbolically the picture of the space of lattices, so this is the space of lattices, and then this space is not so one can have sequences of lattices which don't converge to anything to any lattice, because you can take lattices where one of the vectors shrinks to zero, and so this is exactly what this set k epsilon captures. So we have this a subset of lattices which are a kind of degenerate. So as epsilon goes to zero, then we get more and more degenerate lattices. So here is the key proposition which makes my philosophical claim precise. So this is due to Kleinbock and Margulis. So we claim that there exists a function R, which depends on our function psi, which we defined, which we started with. So again, it goes from positive reals to 0, 1. And it has the following properties. So the vector x in Rd is psi approximable if and only if the corresponding orbit lambda sub x a t n is going to visit this kind of degenerate neighborhoods in the space of lattices. So the orbit lambda sub x a t n visits k r Tn for a sequence Tn going to infinity. So so what we would have, we would have the following picture. So so here we have a point lambda sub x, and then we are considering a flow given by multiplication by the one parameter subgroup a sub t, and so at some point this flow is going to visit this kind of small degenerate neighborhood. And then maybe it would go back and spend some time in the nice part of the space, but then it would go back again and somehow visits even more degenerate neighborhood. And so so in order to prove that x is psi approximable, we really need to study visits of this point lambda sub x into shrinking degenerate neighborhoods. So, so more precisely, we actually have a shrinking family of neighborhoods given by the function r. So somehow the neighborhoods become more and more degenerate, and our orbit must visit eventually visits all of these neighborhoods. So this is somehow a very nice dynamical interpretation of the original number theoretic problem that we started with. So so maybe I should explain why. So how to prove this proposition? So so first I have to define function r. So I'm going to define r by drawing a picture. So r is defined. Defined by so originally we have this function psi which measures the quality of Diophantine approximation, and so what I do, I'm going to draw a line y is equal to e to the minus d plus 1 t times x. So because my function psi is continuous and non-increasing, so there would be a single point where these two curves intersect, and so so then I can look what is the x coordinate, and what is y coordinate, and so then I'm going to write the x coordinate as e to the power dt times r of t, and the y coordinate would be e to the minus t r of t. So once you know x and y coordinate, you can compute what is r of t from this picture. Right, so that's just the definition of function r. And then a convenient feature of this function is the feature which we are going to use in the proof is that if I compute psi of e to the dt r of t, then it's the same as e to the minus t r of t. So now let me maybe prove one direction of the proposition. So the opposite direction is basically similar. So let me show that if the vector x is psi approximable, then we have this property on the right hand side. So let's suppose that if I look on the system of inequalities, say P and Q in ZD times N. So suppose that this system of inequalities has a solution. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to pick the sequence of times Tn such that Rn is equal to the x coordinate here, is equal to d Tn r Tn. Yeah, so that's very convenient because you see if you do it this way, then psi of Rn is easy to compute. So we are going to use this formula. So then psi of Rn can be computed as e to the power minus Tn r of Tn divided by Q. So Rn here. Sorry. So Rn would be equal to e to the d Tn Rtn. Okay. So now what are we getting from this computation? From these two inequalities, I would get that maximum over Okay, so here I can multiply by q and by e to the power tn. So e to the power tn times q I'll write it like this. E to the power tn q x minus p. And e to the power minus dtn q would be less or equal than r of tn. So what is this vector? So now if you recall how we defined our lattice, so that's really so what we are getting, the vector qx minus p q applied times e to the tn, and so the norm, by norm I always mean a maximum norm, so this is exactly the norm of this vector, and so we see that the norm of this vector would be smaller than r of tn, and so that's exactly the property which appears here. So what I see is that I got this non-zero vector with very small norm, and so lambda x. So this is a point in the lattice lambda x, and so this point gives me a short norm, and so lambda x times atn would belong to k of r tn. So indeed, what I have shown is that if the vector x is psi approximable, then I have this dynamical property that the corresponding orbit is going to visit the shrinking neighborhoods. So by the way, this picture and this property which I introduced, it's actually a very common property in dynamical system, and it's called the shrinking target property. So we have a shrinking family of neighborhoods, and then we have a chaotic one-parameter flow, and we want to see whether this one-parameter flow eventually visits this shrinking family of neighborhoods in some reasonable time. In order to prove the Hinchin theorem, we can try to verify this dynamical property. And one of the tools which we can use would be the property that the flow AT is mixing. But in fact, it's not only mixing, but it's mixing with a rate. So I'm going to use exponential mixing property, right? So you've seen the notion of mixing in Karma's lectures last week. So here we actually need a mixing with a quantitative estimate. So I'm going to use exponential mixing property. Exponential mixing property of the flow a sub t. So what this property says is the following. So there exists a constant delta, positive, such that for every smooth function, say f1 and f2, on the space Y, if I look on the correlation f1 y at f2 y dy. So then this correlation behaves as a product of the integrals of those functions plus an error term. So what we want to claim is that as t goes to infinity, then the limit would be the product of the integrals. So, and this is true in a quantitative form, that it's, there would be an error term of the type e to the power minus delta t times some constants depending on the functions f1 and f2, so it wouldn't be so crucial for our sketch of the proof to know what these functions actually are, but those are explicit norms defined for smooth functions, the so-called Sobolev norms. So that's really very important and very important theorem, which has many applications. So maybe just to explain. So far I talked about the space of lattices Y as a set, but in fact it has a very rich structure. So one can introduce a topology on the space, and one can also introduce a natural measure on the space. So of course, to understand this statement, we have to know what the measure on the space Y is, and it turns out that Y supports SL d plus 1 r invariant probability measure. So I haven't really constructed this measure, but that's a really very important measure to work with. And and in particular, because it's a probability measure, so it's convenient to use techniques from dynamical systems to study distribution of flows. So now we have this important theorem, but let me explain how this theorem can be used in our setting. So now finally we are getting to the proof. A dynamical proof of Hinchin theorem. Which was given by Kleinbock and Margulis. And so what we want to show is that, basically we want to verify that this property holds for almost all x in Rd. So because of what I've already said, it's sufficient to prove the following. So we claim that for almost every x in Rd, if I look on lambda x a sub n, so n here is a natural number, so this is going to visit the set k of Rn infinitely often. Uh, So there is one small technical difficulty in applying exponential mixing theorem, because it's only true in the class of smooth functions. But it's not a big deal, because as usual, if you have a characteristic function of an interval, you can always approximate it by a smooth function. So what we do, we approximate characteristic function of the sets of those sets K R n by Fn. So Fn is smooth. So more precisely, we want to have the following properties. So the support of Fn would be contained in the set K Rn, and Fn is non-negative, and also we want that the integral of Fn would be approximately equal to the volume of the sets K Rn. And also we want to control the Sobolev norms of those functions. So we also want to have that the Sobolev norms are bounded up to a constant by the integral of those functions. So it requires some work to construct such a smooth approximation, but the idea is very simple, right? You have a function, and then you kind of smoothen up you have a characteristic function, and then you smoothen up the boundary. So it can be done by taking convolutions with smooth functions. Okay, so now I'm going to consider functions. I have to say one more thing. So I still have to use the property that psi of q to the power d. So this sum is infinite, right? That was the assumption of the Hinchin theorem. So we started with the function psi, but then using this picture, we switched and we introduced a new function r. So now you can analyze what this property of psi means in terms of function r. And it turns out that this is equivalent to sum over Rn to the power d plus 1 is infinite. But another way of writing this property would be in terms of the volumes of the sets k epsilon. So we can also check how the volume of those sets. So as epsilon goes to zero, this family of sets decays right to the empty set, and so one can check that this grows up to a constant as epsilon to the power d plus 1. So those are two basic lemmas that one needs to prove along the proof, needs to check along the proof. And so because of this and also property 2, so we obtain that sum over n integral over yfn. So this sum is infinite. So this is the first property that we are going to use, and also we want well yes. So now basically we want to establish the second property in the converse of Borel-Cantelli lemma, the quasi-independence property, and so we also get that sum over n and m from 1 to big N, fn times a n. So here, if I have a function, so there is a natural way to act. So if you have an action on the space, you can also act on functions. So it's really fn of y times a n. That's what I mean when I write it like this. So I'm claiming that I also have this property. So it's so this would be well, integral plus some constant. So this property would be deduced from exponential mixing. So maybe before I do it here, let me let's see. Let me maybe say what we can get. So assume that we have these two properties. So we have this property and that property. So then we can apply a version of converse of Borel-Cantelli lemma, where instead of sets we have functions. So by converse of Borel-Cantelli lemma, we would get that for almost every y in y, for almost every y in y. So I'm going to apply it to those functions. So then I would get that y times a n would belong to the support of the function f n. And the way we picked, remember that we picked the function so that they approximate the set that we are interested in. So this would be contained in k of Rn. And so this is actually very close to the property that that we claimed. So what we wanted to show that for almost all x, well, where x varies over this one parameter, over this family of lattices lambda sub x. So here it's essentially the property which we wanted, but one still needs an additional step. So maybe since I'm running out of time, I'll so let's see. Yeah, so maybe I just briefly mention, so here is for all y in the space, but how do we, so this property I'll check next time, and then just in 1 minute I'll explain briefly how to go from this statement to that statement. So then everything. for infinitely many n. Yes. So for infinitely many n. Yeah. So that's what Borel-Cantelli lemma tells us. Yeah. For infinitely many n. Yes. That's important. So this is this comes from a version of Borel-Cantelli lemma. So now if I write y as say z d plus 1 times g for g in SL d plus 1 r. So then what this statement tells me is that for almost all g, I have the required property, but I need to prove something slightly different. So what I can do, I can write g as a matrix identity x 1, 0 times a matrix A, B, C, 0. So on a set of full measure of matrices, I can always decompose it like this. And then if I look on y applied to A, T, so this is the same as z d plus 1, 0, and then times A t. So this is exactly lambda sub x, and here I'm getting what? So this is just a matrix computation. So I'm getting A e to the power minus d plus 1 t times b. But then the point is that this matrix here, so as t goes to infinity, so this would be uniformly bounded. So this is uniformly bounded for, well, if A, B, and C are in a compact set. So if we know that this orbit with its this kind of neighborhoods with small norms, and then we multiply it by something bounded. So basically the difference between this orbit and that orbit is something in a bounded set. So it really doesn't change the so if we prove something about almost all y, then we can also deduce something about almost all x because of this remark here. So since I'm running over time, I think I'll finish the proof. So what we are left to do is to check this quasi-independence property, and it turns out that this quasi-independence property would follow from exponential mixing. So I'll explain this point next time. It's actually not very difficult. It may be a couple minutes more, but I think I should stop. So I'll stop here.